Simon & Schuster Audio presents Creole Belle, a Dave Robicheaux novel by James Lee Burke. Read by Will Patton.
Chapter 1. For the rest of the world, the season was still fall, marked by cool nights and the gold-green remnants of summer. For me, down in South Louisiana, in the Garden District of New Orleans, the wetlands that lay far beyond my hospital window had turned to winter, one characterized by stricken woods that were drained of water and strung with a web of gray leaves and dead air vines that had wrapped themselves as tightly as cord around the trees. Those who have had the following experience will not find my descriptions exaggerated or even metaphorical in nature. A morphine dream has neither walls, nor a ceiling, nor a floor. The sleep it provides is like a warm bath, free of concerns about mortality and pain and memories from the past. Morpheus also allows us vision through a third eye that we never knew existed. His acolytes can see through time and become participants in grand events they had believed accessible only through history books and films. On one occasion, I saw a hot air balloon rising from its tether in Audubon Park, a uniformed soldier operating a telegrapher's key inside the wicker basket, while down below other members of the Confederate Signal Corps shared sandwiches and drank coffee from tin cups, all of them as stately and stiff as figures in a sepia-tinted photograph. I don't wish to be too romantic about my experience in the recovery facility there on St. Charles Avenue in Uptown New Orleans. While I gazed through my window at the wonderful green streetcar wobbling down the tracks on the neutral ground, the river fog puffing out of the live oak trees, the pink and purple neon on the Katz and Bestoff drugstore, as effervescent as tentacles of smoke twirling from marker grenades, I knew, with a sinking heart, that what I was seeing was an illusion, that in reality, the Katz and Bestoff drugstore and the umbrella-covered snowball carts along St. Charles and the musical gaiety of the city had slipped into history long ago, and somewhere out on the edge of my vision, the onset of permanent winter waited for me. Though I'm a believer, that did not lessen the sense of trepidation I experienced in these moments. I felt as if the sun were burning a hole in the sky, causing it to blacken and collapse like a giant sheet of carbon paper suddenly crinkling and folding in on itself, and I had no power to reverse the process. I felt that a great darkness was spreading across the land, not unlike ink spilling across the face of a topographic map. Many years ago, when I was recovering from wounds I received in a Southeast Asian country, a United States Army psychiatrist told me that my morphine-induced dreams were creating what he called a world destruction fantasy, one that had its origins in childhood and the dissolution of one's natal family. He was a scientist and a learned man, and I did not argue with him. Even at night, when I lay in a berth on a hospital ship, far from free fire zones and the sound of ammunition belts popping under a burning hooch, I did not argue, nor did I contend with the knowledge of the psychiatrist when dead members of my platoon spoke to me in the rain and a mermaid with an Asian face beckoned to me from a coral cave strung with pink fans, her hips spangled with yellow coins, her mouth parting, her naked breasts as flushed with color as the inside of a conch shell. The cult of Morpheus is a strange community indeed, and it requires that one take up residence in a country where the improbable becomes commonplace. No matter what I did, nor how many times I disappeared out my window into the mists along St. Charles Avenue, back into an era of rooftop jazz bands and historical streetcars filled with men in bowler hats and women who carried parasols. The watery gray rim of a blighted planet was always out there, intransigent and corrupt, a place where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal. In the early a.m. on a Friday, I asked the black attendant to open the windows in my room. It was against the rules, but the attendant was an elderly and kind man who had spent 5 days on a rooftop after the collapse of the levees during Hurricane Katrina, and he wasn't given to concerns about authority. The windows reached to the ceiling and were hung with ventilated green shutters that were closed during the heat of the day to filter the sun's glare. The attendant opened both the glass and the shutters and let in the night smell of the roses and camellias and magnolia and rain mist blowing through the trees. The air smelled like bayou tesh when it's spring and the fish are spawning among the water hyacinths and the frogs are throbbing in the cattails and the flooded cypress. It smelled like the earth may have smelled during the first days of creation, before any five-toed footprints appeared along the banks of a river. Or at least I think the black man opened the windows. Even to this day, I cannot be sure of what I said and saw and heard that night. Like the drunkard who fears both his memory and his dreams, I had become cynical about my perceptions, less out of fear that they were illusions than a conviction that they were real. After the black man had left the room, I turned my head on the pillow and looked into the face of a Cajun girl by the name of Tee Jolie Melton.
"Hi, Mr. Dave," she said. "I read all about the shooting in the papers. You was on television, too. I didn't know you was here in New Orleans. I'm sorry to see you hurt like this. You was talking French in your sleep."
"It's nice to see you, Tee Jolie. How'd you get in?" I said.
"Through the front door. You want me to come back another time?
Can you get me a glass of water?"
"I got you better than that. I brought you a Dr. Pepper and a lime I cut up, because that's what you always drank when you came into the club. I brought you something else, too. It's an iPod I filled with music. I loaded Beat Me Daddy 8 to the bar on it, because I knew how you always liked that song."
Her eyes were blue-green, her hair long and mahogany-colored with twists of gold in it that were as bright as buttercups. She was part Indian and part Cajun and part black and belonged to that ethnic group we call Creoles, although the term is a misnomer.
"You're the best," I said.
"Remember when you helped me with my car crash? You were so kind. You took care of everything, and I didn't have no trouble at all because of it."
"It wasn't a car crash, as I recalled. It was at least 3 car crashes, but I didn't pursue the point." The most interesting aspect of Tee Jolie's auto accidents were her written explanations at the scene. To the best of my memory, these were her words.
"I was backing up when this light pole came out of nowhere and smashed into my bumper. I was turning left, but somebody was blocking the lane, so trying to be polite, I switched my turn indicator and cut to the school parking lot, but I didn't have no way of knowing the chain was up on the drive at that time of day, because it never is. When the transmission went into reverse, Mr. Fontenot was putting my groceries in the back seat, and the door handle caught his coat sleeve and drug him across the street into the gas pump that blew up. I tried to give him first aid on the mouth, but he had already swallowed his big wad of gum that the fireman had to pull out with his fingers. I think Mr. Fontenot almost bit off one of the fireman's fingers and didn't have the courtesy to say he was sorry."
Tee Jolie fixed a glass of ice and Dr. Pepper with a lime slice and stuck a straw in it and held it up to my mouth. She was wearing a long-sleeved shirt printed with purple and green flowers. Her skirt was pale blue and fluffy and pleated, and her shoes looked tiny on her feet. You could say that Tee Jolie was made for the camera. Her natural loveliness of a kind that begged to be worshipped on a stage or hung on a wall. Her face was thin, her eyes...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.